Father, we need you every hour. As we are standing in this place, we need you. We need you to touch our hearts, that we can be present here, even as your word goes forth. May you grant your blessing upon the speaker. May you grant faith also on the ears listening, that Lord, at the end of this service, we may be able to say our hearts were warmed up by the word. As your word goes forth, may it heal. As your word goes forth, may it break whatever captivity. For Lord, we come into your house with various needs. And this is like a hospital to us. Others are discouraged. Lord, may they be encouraged. Others are sick in their bodies. Lord, may you grant your healing. Others may be backslidden. May you restore them. All of us, Lord, may each of our cups go back home being filled with something. Lord, we humble ourselves before you. Take away any pride, any bitterness, anything that doesn't smell like you. Lord, uproot it out of our hearts. For many a times we do things we may not even be aware of, that you may not be happy of. Lord, forgive us of all such things. May our prayers and praise and worship ascend to heaven like a sweet-smelling savour, that it may be acceptable before thee. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The Lord richly bless you.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord a clap offering. You may be seated, saints. The couple which married, are they here? Ah, they're not yet here. Well, maybe they're still enjoying love. He's not yet married, forgive him. He doesn't know how to interpret that. Well, we are so happy to be here. And I was told to introduce the people I came with. I came with Nora, my wife. I can't see where she is. You can stand so that people see you. So there was a time I used to come here as a small boy. I've been growing up and now I'm a man.
And
when you are of age, you need to get married. No, I'm just hugging him. I'm not preaching to him.
So,
that is my wife.
So,
she's not just a wife, but she's a friend. So, and I believe marriage becomes sweet when you are married, but you are also friends and you are in love. So the Lord has blessed us with two boys. Yeah, and seeing the United Nations are saying the world is so overpopulated. So, the Lord willing, we may end there. I say, the Lord willing. Okay, I can see the protest. Maybe we'll end at 7. Wow, look at that response. All right, pray for us to have that faith. So, our older son is Joshua. He's 9 years old. And the other one is Terry. He just turned 4. It is my prayer the Lord raises them up as missionaries one day. They can choose whatever career they want, but if God can put His word as a burning fire in their hearts. I believe that should be the desire of every parent. Amen. So I came with our head deacon in our fellowship in Lusaka. Brother John Mwanza. You can stand. As he's still standing, when we were back together at school, at Munali, yeah, he used to be our deputy head boy. I used to be the head boy. My wife used to be one of my prefects. There wasn't any relationship whatsoever. God bless you, brother. You can sit. And we used to have scripture union. I used to be the chairperson of the scripture union. He used to be the vice chairperson. Brother Chavula used to be at Kablonga Boys. And so I used to invite him sometimes to come and preach at Munali. So you know, Brother Chavula, I can't make him stand. He's here. So during the scripture union, I started preaching the message. I would distribute spoken word books and prophetic revelation by Brother Gan. And some contenders. So he started reading that. My wife also had gotten some prophetic revelation books. Like others. So she started reading that. And she accepted and believed that. And today we have him as a deacon. She's there as my wife. And it's been a great blessing having this family of God. Amen. Brother Mansa couldn't come with his wife. He has more faith than I have. He has a new baby, and that makes how many kids? Three. He has four kids. The first three are boys. So they kept praying for a girl. They already bought pink clothes. And so they have a girl. You can give it another try, another girl can come. Alright, the Lord richly bless you all. Now, the main purpose of my coming, I really wanted to visit the pastor after he got sick last time. So, we were praying for him. That the Lord takes him out of the hospital. Unfortunately, that time when he got sick, we had a trip to go to Zimbabwe. We really desired to come here and just show our love. So we thought, okay, since there is a wedding coming in, I think we can travel at that same time. So we are happy to find him better. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Sorry. You see, that's the problem of being single. I forgot to introduce Brother Robert. Can you stand, man? Okay. Thank you, Brother Chavula. You know, that's another brother I came with. Now, I want us to look at one scripture. The other day, I received a phone call. It was coming from an elderly Indian woman. But very faithful, a wonderful believer. And she asked a Bible question. She said, "Brother Phiri, can you explain this to me? What should we do first during Holy Communion?" Do we wash our feet first? Or we are supposed to eat the Lord's Supper? Now that was a profound question. Because the sequence of what happened during the Lord's Supper is described somewhat different in the different Gospels. But when you look closely, it's not really different. You just need to pay close attention. Matthew wrote about the Holy Communion. Mark wrote about it. Luke wrote about it. John talked about it. And each of them gives certain details which are missing in the other book. Now, we don't want just to take it as a study, but I want to speak on a thought that I title "That Empty Seat." And I pray the Lord ministers to all of us. And the question we are looking at is, apart from what I said earlier, was Judas Iscariot present when the Lord was giving out the communion? Let us go to the book of Luke chapter 22 as we stand. Luke 22 verse 14. Remember the two questions we're looking at. What comes first? Holy Communion or feet washing? Now, whatever order is written, there's no problem. Whether you start with communion or whether you start with washing, the two events have different meanings. But if one says, "I want to do it strictly the way the Lord Jesus did," we want to see how exactly did the Lord do it. Now let's look at Luke chapter 22.
Luke 22,
verse 14.
Verse 14.
With your Bibles, can we all read together? Whether you are reading it in Bemba, in English, I want to hear your voice. Let us read verse 14. "And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him." May the Lord richly bless the reading of his word. Heavenly Father, we yield our thoughts and our minds to you. May you speak to us as we open forth the scriptures. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated, saints. According to this verse, how many apostles were with Jesus as they sat on the table? There were 12, right? "And when the hour was come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. And then he tells them something. Verse
15.
"And he said unto them, with desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." For I say unto you, I will not anymore eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God
shall.
And he took bread and gave thanks and break it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper. Everyone say after supper. Saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. Now, I want you to pay close attention to verse 21. From verse 21 to verse 27. But behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. Now that really sounds like Judas is with Jesus. And truly the Son of Man goeth as it was determined. But woe unto that man by whom he is betrayed. And they began to inquire among themselves which of them it was that should do this thing. Let's all of us read verse
24.
And there was also a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest. So, as they are eating this supper, there was actually an argument which rose among them. Who is the greatest among us? Who is greater? Well, we still have those problems today.
Not quite a man feels worried.
One minister wants to know whether he's greater than other ministers, and others believe the unity of the faith in the message will come when we recognize one man as the apostle, and all that thing. Now remember, previously, the disciples had this argument. And Jesus had called a young child. Be humble like this child. And when you read it, it looks like they heard what he explained. But before he died, the argument started again on the
table.
You know, this was before people received the Holy Spirit. When you walk in the flesh and you don't walk in the spirit, you want to be the center of everything. One important fruit of the Holy Spirit in you, you have to have humility. Always think of another brother and sister to be better than you. So these people have this strife, they're arguing.
Yeah.
And the Lord says, verse 25, and he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. But ye shall not be so. But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger. And he that is chief, as he that doth serve. For whether is greater, he that sitteth at meat or he that serveth? Is not he that sitteth at meat? But I'm among you as he that serveth. Now let's understand this. The way Luke wrote the narration of these events, He summarized a lot of things. Luke does not tell everything which happened on that table. But he tells us certain details which the other three Gospels do not tell us. For example, the other three Gospels, they don't tell us that there was an argument on the table. Who is the greatest among us? But when you take all these Gospels and bring them together, you will have a good understanding of how these events unfolded. Now you need to understand this thing about Luke. Number one,
Luke,
at the beginning of his Gospel, he says he was writing things in order of how they happened. But when you look closely, the order in which he writes some things, it's not order according to time, but order according to subject. Let me ask you a simple question. When was John the Baptist thrown into prison? Was it before or after he baptized Jesus? You can raise your hand. When was John thrown into prison? Was it before or after he had baptized Jesus? Let's see those who read the Bible. Yes, brother. After the baptism of Jesus, right? After the baptism of Jesus, right? Well, that is true. Because we know that when John went into prison, the next thing that happened is he was beheaded, he was killed, right? He never came out of prison. From prison he was beheaded. But I want to draw your attention to the way Luke wrote his events. Let us go to Luke, I think that is chapter 3.
Luke chapter 3.
Luke chapter 3 talks about the preaching of John the Baptist.
Luke chapter 3,
so let's read Luke 3, verse 18.
Luke chapter 3, verse 18.
And many other things in his exhortation preached he unto the people. That is John the Baptist. But Herod, the tetrarch, being reproved by him for Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, and for all the evils which Herod had done, added yet this above all, that he shut up John in prison. Verse 21. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened. Are you seeing the problem there? Have you seen the problem?
Amen.
John the Baptist is thrown into prison. And the way Luke writes, it's as though Jesus is baptized later. But when you read in other Gospels, you actually realize that Jesus was baptized before John was thrown into prison. Now, for you to understand this, you need to know the writing style of Luke. The way Luke writes his gospel, he wants to complete one subject before he begins another. So in certain places, he writes things according to the order of the theme or topic he's talking about. So when he is talking about John the Baptist, he tells everything which happened to John the Baptist. What he taught. He speaks everything about John the Baptist. Then he starts now talking about Jesus Christ. Are you seeing how he writes? So first he writes everything what happened to John the Baptist. And he doesn't want to talk about Jesus. He first wants to finish everything that happened to John. Then from that verse, where now it talks about Jesus' baptism, he no longer talks about John. He has now started a new topic on Jesus. But in speaking about Jesus, he reminds us that Jesus had been baptized by John. And that is why when reading the scripture, you need to read between the lines. Otherwise, you may think scripture contradicts itself. So, there are certain places Luke does not go in detail. Like the Lord's Supper. When he begins to talk about Jesus breaking bread and eating, he talks about everything that happened to do with the eating. Then he moved on to Jesus talking about who will betray him. He starts another subject. But now, let us go to John. Now, you need to understand another thing here. Luke was not among the 12 disciples. Did you know that? Whatever Luke wrote, he was told by the other disciples. Luke was not one of the 12 disciples. But we want to go to one of the 12 disciples who was there on the table. Because he tells us certain important things. That is John. Now, when you look at Matthew, when you look at what he wrote on what happened on that table, Matthew was paying attention to what Jesus was doing. He took bread, took wine, but John is different. When you read the Gospel of John, he was more interested in what Jesus was talking. So you find John, he wrote so many things Jesus said before he was crucified. He goes in detail on how Jesus prayed. And so we are going to read these things in parallel. Now, notice one thing here. Luke told us something. That the disciples were arguing, who is the greatest? And then Jesus begins to say, who is greater? Him that eats on the table? Or he that serves? And then Luke says, Jesus said,
yes, what did?
But me, although I'm your master, I'm like one who serves. I'm not on the table.
So
one thing you need to realize is this. When they gathered that evening to eat the supper, Jesus was eating with them.
Yes, I had another.
But at a certain point, he had stood up, moved away from the table, and said, who is greater? Him that eats on the table? Or him who is a servant serving people?
On the table?
Now, Luke only tells us about the argument they had. But John actually tells us what Jesus did when he stood away from the table. Luke only records the words that Jesus said, you know, you need to humble
yourselves to each
other.
But John actually tells us the Lord had taken a basin of water.
Yes,
and was actually cleaning their feet as he was explaining. Now let us go to John. And we see a breakdown of how these things happen. Are we together?
Amen.
Or is it boring?
No.
Okay. Now let us go to John chapter 13. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. Verse
1.
Now, all eyes on verse 2. And that is where confusion begins. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Hold there. Now, when you read this, it sounds like supper had ended. It sounds like the Holy Communion had ended. In verse 4, he riseth from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples. It really sounds like supper had ended. When Jesus took the basin of water and begins to wash
the
feet. But let me make a very big announcement. King James Version English had phrased that sentence wrongly.
By King James Version, by Ndola,
supper had ended. That's what it says. Verse 4. He riseth from supper. How does he rise from that which ended? Verse 26. Jesus answered,
yes, why are you?
He it is to whom I shall give a soap when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the soap. So what you read in verse 26, supper is actually still going on. Because the Lord Jesus says, the person whom I will dip within the dip as we are eating. So they were actually still eating. Now don't worry. Other Bible versions corrected the error in King James Version. Anyone with the new NIV, New International Version?
NIV?
Or any version apart from King James Version? All of you want King James, because yes, it's reliable, but certain places it's not reliable. NIV, any other version? Apart from King James Version. Even on the phones, no one has it. Okay, I have it in my head. Alright, I can see a hand there. What version is that? Very good. Can you read it? No. John 13 verse 2.
John chapter 13, verse 2.
Sister, can you come? We want to hear it through the microphone so that everyone understands. John 13, verse 2.
John chapter 13, verse 2.
Yes. You can let her read through the microphone.
The evening meal was being served. And the devil had
hot. Can you read again?
The evening meal was being served.
The Lord bless you, sister, can bear
it.
Are you seeing the difference? The evening meal was being served. When you read the American Standard Version, it says, during the supper. When you read the Jerusalem Bible, it says again, during the supper. So you can see that. You can check it in all other Bible versions. Now when you take it to the Greek, the original language in which they wrote it in, when it says, and supper being ended, in Greek it actually shows that supper was still continuing when the Lord's, when the feet washing started. So, in King James Version, and supper being ended, that was wrong translation.
King James
Now, notice this. Here is what happened. They're supposed to eat the Passover meal. Now, how did they used to eat that? You need to know that it was not just bread and wine. No.
How?
They would kill a lamb, right? So, this is a big feast. Let us read in Matthew. But put something in John because we are coming back. I want you to see that before the holy part of the communion was done, the supper meal had already started. They were already eating something. Now let's go to Matthew. That should be in verse 26. Yes, Matthew 26, verse 19.
Matthew chapter 26, verses 19.
And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed them. And they made ready the Passover. Now, when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12. So they are all 12 at the beginning. But notice what happens in verse
21.
And as they did eat, what are they eating? This Passover meal. An evening meal. It was a feasting, you know. As they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. Verse 22, and they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. So they're eating something. This is supper. This is not the Holy Communion. Now, they start with supping, eating. Then he says, the one who supped with me. Verse
25.
Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? He said unto him, thou hast said. So Judas says, is it I? So you said it. Now when you read it in Matthew, it's like after he tells that to Judas, Jesus continues doing other things. Verse 26. And as they were eating,
They're still eating the supper. But as they were eating, Jesus took bread. Now this is when the Holy Communion begins. And this is a new thing in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, when the Passover meal was commissioned, people are taught to eat unleavened bread and the Passover meal. Bitter herbs. But through time in history, wine was introduced on the table. That's a new thing. You don't see it when Moses is telling them about the Passover. But there was wine which started through time being served as part of the feast. But of course, unleavened bread was always there. But here's something. As they were eating, just like in all other places, they were eating that evening meal. Because Jews used to observe the Passover in all the different houses. But at the table where Jesus was sitting with his disciples, something new was initiated. The Passover meal, in all the other houses, they would narrate the story of how people were delivered from Egypt. That is what they were remembering about. But at the Last Supper, the Lord Jesus brings in something which was not in the minds of the disciples. No, he did not read to them about the Exodus story like it was happening in other homes. In these other homes, people are just eating the lamb meat. But these disciples, the real lamb is seated before them. And he tells them, the wine is my blood. The bread is my body. And so he begins what today we call the Holy Communion. It was an event which happened during the supper. So it's not the whole supper that was the Holy Communion. As they were supping that evening, the Lord Jesus fed in this new event. We call it the Holy Communion. And it says, take it, this is my body. That is what Matthew forecasts on. You know, there were a number of them on this table. They all wrote a story about what happened with different details. Matthew, he was able to remember about the Judas incident. When Judas said, is it I, Lord? The Lord says, yeah. You've said it. But Matthew does not tell us what happened next. He just tells us, and as they were eating. But hey, there's something which happened after Judas was told that, which Matthew did not take down. But John was very observant to what Jesus was speaking. And he wrote what all the other three did not write. And let us go now to John. Now John is called the beloved disciple. And he paid close attention to what the Lord was saying. Now let's go back to John. John 13. We are speaking about that empty seat. John 13 verse 2.
John 13 verse 2.
During supper.
Kabiri idio marenga mulariro.
What is happening during this supper? He says in verse 4. The Lord riseth from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel. He pours the water into the basin and begins to wash their feet. Why did he start doing that? Look toward us. They started saying, who is the greatest among us? Everyone wants to show like they are important. The Lord was quiet, listening to what was going on. He did not identify with the pride they had. He could see there is something they were still missing. They thought this new kingdom is about importance. Positions. So the Lord Jesus moves away from the table. As they keep on talking, he takes a basin of water, washes their feet. And when he reaches Peter, this is what happens. Verse 6. Then cometh he to Simon Peter. And Peter said unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now. You don't know. You don't understand. But thou shalt know hereafter. Peter says unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. Let me say something here. Peter was an elderly person. Jesus was young.
Yes, what do you mean?
Jesus, at this time, he's about 33 years old.
Yes,
you know, I was watching a certain movie and they showed John the Baptist like an old man baptizing people. That's not correct. You know, Jesus and John the Baptist, they were about 6 months different in age. So when Jesus is doing this, he's about 33 years old. He's a young person. But they respected him because of the ministry and the word he was carrying. And when he came to wash the feet of Peter, you need to know that feet washing, when you wash the feet of someone, that was a job of a servant in the house. Now, you may not understand that until you are in Asia. You know, when I went to India, I didn't know. You don't enter with your shoes in the houses. It's an Eastern custom. You will understand that when you go to their country. It's not just a doctrine, it's their culture. Now, it used to be in those days, you know, when you are walking in the streets and in the roads, your feet step on different things. You step on poop. You step on dirty things. Now imagine with the same shoes, we Africans, we enter with them in the house. Now imagine if there's a little baby. Babies walk even with their hands, they touch the floor.
So
if you had stepped on feces, although your shoes look clean, there is bacteria you've actually brought into the house. And when a child touches that, whilst it is crawling, the next thing is it touches the mouth. So, You see the logic behind taking off shoes. So I thought, okay, I think in my house I'll put a little India. Yeah, so you find that tradition in my house. You take off your shoes. I thought that's a good lesson
there.
It's not a doctrine. But I just felt it's a good practice they have. Amen. So now, when you are tired, you reach a house. There will be a maid, a servant, who will rush to take off your shoes. They'll clean your face. Now, a person who was doing that has to be a servant. But here, the Lord, all these people are eating on the supper table. They're thinking about who is greater. So the Lord excuses himself. He looks around, takes a person, and he starts washing their feet. And when it comes to Peter, I believe they are all surprised. What is he doing now? But one thing about Peter, he used to talk. He was actually, I think, the most talkative among all them. John used to be very quiet. But Peter used to talk a lot. So when the Lord comes to him, maybe others were quiet. They are surprised. What is the master doing? But Peter says, no. You can't do that to me. You are my master. You can't wash my feet. The Lord says, well, you don't understand what I'm doing now. No way about it. Lord, you can't wash my face. And the Lord says, if I don't do this to you, you have no part with me. She said, if it is that, Lord, wash my head and my hands. But the Lord says something. No, if you are already clean, you already bathed. There's no need to wash your hair then. You are clean. But not everyone here. You know why he said that? Let's read verse 10. Why did the Lord say, you are clean, but not all of you? Because there is one gentleman sitting on that table. He was not clean. Verse 10.
But then
Jesus says to him, he that is washed needeth not self to wash his feet, but is clean every whit, and you are clean, but not all. For he knew who should betray him, therefore said he, you are not all clean. Now you know who was not clean, right? Him that would betray him, Judas. So when the Lord says, you are clean, Peter, we need to take that in its context. Clean as in being with the Lord. But you know, although Judas is with these people, his heart had been conspiring with those people who were looking for Jesus. Peter had his witnesses. For example, later on in the same conversation, the Lord told him, you will deny me 3 times. But that was out of fear. So Peter was still clean in the context of what the Lord meant. So he tells them, you are not all clean. Verse 12.
So after he had washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again. So after he finishes, he goes back to the table. And then he tells them, I've given you an example. You need to be humble. Our kingdom is not like of the world. Now, those are words Luke records. But John has given us a background. He actually tells us what the Lord was doing when he spoke those words. Verse 18. I speak not of you all. I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled, he that eateth bread with me hath lifted up his heel against me. The Holy Communion has not yet started. Are we together? They're still eating the supper meal. Verse 26. Jesus answered,
yes, why you speak?
He it is to whom I shall give a soap when I have dipped it. This is the normal meal. Now, notice what the Lord did. And when he had dipped the soap, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Watch what happens.